Hello, my name is Svetlana Silivanova. I'm in the BrainPool program since 2019 at KAIST, which is here on the right in this picture. I will tell you a little more detail about my stay at KAIST and my experience with BrainPool at the end of my talk. Right now, let me present my project, partial differential equations in exact real computation. Here is the outline of my talk. First, I will tell you about the objectives and motivation of this project and about an important sub-project, namely classifying partial differential equations by their algorithmic complexity, as well as tell you about our current findings in this, in both complexity of partial differential equations and current progress on exact real computation algorithms designed for solving PDEs. I will conclude by our current achievements and activities in the BrainPool program and some of our future work plans. So, objectives and motivation will address the following main questions. What is exact real computation? How can it help solve partial differential equations? And why it is so important for many applications? This last question is maybe the easiest to answer and even to see in the pictures. So in the applications, computing with guaranteed prescribed precision is very important. First main reason for this is if we don't know how to control our error bounds and don't have the result precise, we can run into trouble and even accidents and disasters like collapse of the bridge, crashes of the airplanes, explosion of shuttles, and so on. And second main reason is if we want to compute something for very small scale applications, like in particle physics, it's very desirable to have arbitrary small and very high precision. So summarizing, it would be really great for the numerical packages which do the computation to have the results of computation as accurate as possible and have a full control over the possible error bounds. In the same time, there currently existed software packages which are very highly developed, still are restricted at least by the floating points, which can give at most 53 digits of output, even with double precision, which is really good, but sometimes might be not enough. And also, many programs contain complicated sequences of computation, which are hidden from the user. And sometimes it is hard to say how these floating errors accumulate throughout the sequence of computation. And for problems with big modulus of continuity or even discontinuous, there can be just wrong results, which means if the inputs are very close, the outputs can be very different and floating points are not enough to capture this and we can run into errors. So exact real computation approach actually aims to resolve this problem systematically and treat real numbers exactly. So what does it mean? Does it make any sense? So real numbers are infinite sequences of digits and computers have only finite amount of memory. So exact is understood in this sense that we want to compute with arbitrary given precision 2 to the power minus n. That means compute any n digits versus just 53 digits and the n is given by the user and the program determines how many digits on the input we need to have and keeps track of the errors to obtain the result with the guaranteed prescribed precision 2 to the power minus n. And there are already some numerical packages based on these principles being developed over the last centuries, like IRAM, Ariadne, EARN. And we are in fact in contact and collaboration with developers of some of these packages, and we are aiming at creating exact real computation solvers for partial differential equations, and ultimately to contribute to these packages and use them for applications. Also, we are developing all the necessary theory for it. Let me tell you some more detail. First, let me remind you what are partial differential equations. They are describing very many, very various applications and processes evolving in several directions, like time and space, maybe several dimensions, like the applications I just showed you before. Important phenomena from nature and engineering are modeled by partial differential equations. Here on the upper right, there is a general form of a partial differential equation. So these equations include some differential operator with partial derivatives and some additional conditions, like maybe initial conditions at the time level zero, or on the boundary of some domain, and we want, for example, to find how the process evolves with time or inside this domain. So these types of questions, and for example, here below this general form is a wave equation which describes the acoustics or water waves, and heat equation which describes the distribution of the heat, and many more processes like elasticity, electromagnetism, fluid and gas dynamics, some processes in neuroscience and quantum physics and so on are described by PDEs. So they are very important. And of course, they are studied by many people throughout the recent centuries, especially with the beginning of the computer era. Over the last century, many numerical methods for PDEs are developed, also analytical methods and very rich theory. However, still the current numerical methods and packages suffer from this floating point error issue and computational instabilities, and still remain highly limited without an overall theoretical framework. This diagram shows not everything, but the part of the big variety of all the different types of partial differential equations, problems posed for them. This is on the left, and on the right, there are all the many methods used to solve PDEs. And our goals are first develop a uniform framework for computation with guaranteed arbitrary precision for as many of these problems as possible, with precision 2^-n, where n is the number of the digits we want to get, and we want to compute an approximation to the exact solution, which differs at most by this precision. And an intermediate goal for it is classifying all the partial differential equations by their algorithmic complexity. I will tell you more on this soon. Based on this classification, we develop and implement optimal and reliable algorithms. So here is this motivation to consider complexity. Before implementing any algorithm, we need to first understand what amount of resources like time or memory cells is needed to solve a particular problem using this algorithm. For example, so n is our main input parameter, how many digits we want to get. And if our computation is polynomial in n, then this will be a feasible algorithm and can indeed compute with an arbitrary precision, especially if the degree of this polynomial is not that big. Then if the running time is even better than polynomial, for example, logarithmic, then this algorithm will be very fast. But if the running time is exponential, like 2 to the power n or something like this, then our algorithm might be not feasible and even run for like a million years, or all the computers in the on the Earth, their memory cells will be not enough to make this computation. So, and then if we, for example, design and analyze several algorithms, we might ask the question, but which algorithm is actually optimal and best for the particular problem? So that's another very important question to consider. And turns out this whole topic is not so trivial and requires deep connection with the classical discrete complexity theory, even going to the famous PNP millennium problem, which you might have heard of. This P is the class of algorithms running in polynomial time. So basically feasible algorithms. Yes, NP is non-deterministic polynomial. P space, for example, is the class of algorithms using polynomial amount of memory cells. Exponential time is class of algorithms running in exponential time, so not feasible algorithms, which is obviously different from the polynomial time algorithms. But in between of this diagram, which you see here on the picture, it is not known yet whether these classes coincide or no, whether P is equal to NP in P space, whether this hierarchy collapses or no. But people by now believe that these complexity classes are different, and it makes a lot of sense if we don't yet have a polynomial time algorithm, ask at least if it is in maybe in polynomial space, at least something better than just exponential time. So we study this questions in detail for PDEs, and our strategy is this. So first we take some methods for solving a class of partial differential equations, and we analyze this method in terms of complexity, like running time and memory cells on the parameter n. And then after having analyzed several different methods adapted to the exact real computation approach, we try to figure out for the initial PDE problem which complexity class is optimal for this problem. It means that no better algorithm can potentially exist. And here on this diagram, which is circled by red, are the classes of equations and methods which we made a significant progress in studying these questions, and underlined our nearest next steps. This diagram shows that this research brings together several very different fields from analysis and numerical methods, which is considered continuous mathematics, to logic, computer science, and complexity theory, including discrete mathematics. So these directions are highly developed and developing mainly separately from each other, but this research nicely brings them together, and building this bridge is really helping to address the above mentioned problems. So here are some of our current findings. In the complexity part, we made especially significant progress on classifying the evolutionary systems of PDEs. Evolutionary means that we know how the process behaves at some initial time point, and then we track the evolution of this process in time. Here on the bottom left, there is a general form of these equations. And in the left column of this table, you can see how our classification of this kind of problems depends on the functional class, on the how difficult the initial data is. If the initial data is nice and smooth, analytic, it's called here analytic, it can be represented as an analytic series, then turns out there can be a polynomial algorithm. We had devised such an algorithm and shown this whole class of problems being in P polynomial time. And if the initial data is a little worse, not completely smooth, finitely smooth CK, then at least with the popular finite difference schemes method, we have proved that there cannot be any polynomial time algorithm. That's a surprising finding. However, that's what we have found. And for some particular equations, for example, for the heat equation, we have actually established that unless the initial data is analytic, we cannot find any polynomial time algorithm. The second column of this table is showing that before analogs of these results were obtained for just one equation, for the Laplace equation Poisson problem for it, and we are now studying much broader classes and carefully investigate them. The third column is about quasi-linear equations, like for example, gas dynamics. And for them, by now, we don't have any polynomial time algorithms and still investigating this class. Here is a summary of what I just said. So for analytic systems, which are actually a broad class of systems, so even the heat and wave and acoustic and electromagnetic and so on, equations with good enough initial data, there is a feasible algorithm achieved by analytic series. For finite difference methods, Even if the initial data are analytic and good, we have by now found at least at best a polynomial space algorithm. In some particular cases, it can be improved. Like for the periodic case, it can be improved to so-called sharp P on this diagram, the class in between P space and P. This popular method cannot give any polynomial time algorithms for exact real computation. So we need to think of something else. And right now, for quasi-linear equations too, it is at best sharp P by now, so not polynomial time. Two main conclusions here. For the analytic case, we have a good polynomial time algorithm and we can implement it. That's good news. And the second conclusion is maybe we need a more general framework to include more complicated equations and more functional classes. We are working on such a framework now. And here is our current progress on the actual implementations in the exact real computation approach. So we take this good polynomial time method, and currently we have tested it on the acoustics equations. Here on the left, it is a system of equations, and elasticity medium equations on the right on the slide. And our current computations run up to precision 2^-300. So compute 300 digits of the output. Here is the lab where I'm working in. And let me move on to our general achievements and activities. On the right, upper right of this picture is Martin Ziegler, my host of the BrainPool program. And I have been working in his lab from 2019. It's a very creative and supportive environment. Here are our students and PhD students. And BrainPool is enabling us to systematically study this topic, partial differential equations in exact real computation, and foster collaborations all around the world. Here are some of our publications during the BrainPool program. Several papers more are in progress right now. During the BrainPool program, we have organized a conference at KAIST, which was last year, the Korean-Japanese workshop. And I was invited to make 3 talks at international conferences during this period, as well as we, our group, just made many talks at other conferences. I'm now serving as a program committee member at one of our main conferences, Computability in Europe, which will be held next year. And last year I made a mini course of lectures about partial differential equations applied to computability and computations at KAIST. Let me highlight some of our most memorable events. This is this Korean-Japanese workshop we organized last year at KAIST. It was a workshop on algorithms and computation and brought together many excellent researchers, mainly from Korea and Japan, also some researchers from Europe. It was a very nice 2-day workshop. And right after this workshop, some members of our group went to the Shonan meeting in Japan, which was also a very memorable event. Here's the Mount Fuji is right behind us. So this workshop was devoted to higher order complexity theory and its applications. And higher order means that we were working on developing the framework of complexity, not just functions, but functionals, like functions acting on functions. It's a very difficult topic, but this event helped to achieve significant progress on it. This is a Korean Mathematical Society online meeting held this year online, and I'm very happy to be a member of the Korean Mathematical Society. It was also a great experience. Let me say a few words about our future plans to conclude this talk. So we are planning to study the optimality question further and optimize our algorithms and study complexity for other classes of partial differential equations and develop the actual PDE solvers. Yes, and study this more general functional classes and hopefully even nonlinear processes. This is another very memorable event of the BrainPool program, namely this same networking event held in Seoul in 2019. Hopefully we all will meet soon offline again. Right now, I'm very happy to be here with you online and looking forward to your questions. I want to thank the organizer for this opportunity to talk at this networking event. And thank you very much for your attention. Mm-hmm.